You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple and beyond. Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 38, Ian Gillan Band, Child in Time. And coming to you from the home of the Chicago-style hot dog, I'm your host, Nathan Beaudry.
And coming to you from the suburbs of Providence, it's your co-host, John the Bucket Mottola.
It's like a mystery every week to try to crack the code.
Yeah.
The Bucket.
Yeah, the Bucket, as in the town 6 miles away from me, Pawtucket.
Oh, the Bucket.
The Bucket.
I don't know if I ever heard that, the Pawtucket being referred to as the Bucket.
Yeah. Or they're like, so where do you live? And they're just like, the Bucket.
The Bucket. Rhode Island.
Well, it's just like where you, it's like one of the maybe, I don't know, half a dozen towns that have a nickname as far as I know. Your old one had a Woonie.
Yeah,
Woonieville.
Woonieville, yep.
Yeah.
Home of the Woonsocket Rockets.
Yeah, I was looking for one for Lincoln, but they don't have one. Stinking Lincoln, I don't know.
Stinking Lincoln, yeah.
John, Stinking Lincoln. No, I don't know. So
yeah, I was gonna say
of my own. So
there's that little mile marker on the path that goes, you know, that little stretch when you were like going on your way to my house where you pass the sign, it says like entering Smithfield, and like 3 seconds later, it's like entering Lincoln. It's like this tiny little, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
Right after when you go to, through the underpass, you're like in Smithfield for not even 3 seconds. There's a little mile marker there, and it says like there's one side that says Woonsocket, one side that says Lincoln, and one side that says
yeah. And it's like yeah, you're like literally in like a town for like 30 seconds.
Not yeah, even. So it's like the Four Corners thing, you know, in Utah, Colorado, except way less exciting.
My favorite is like on my way to Boston, if you're going up to like 95, there's like a town in there like Sharon. Mm-hmm. And like the sign says entering Sharon. And every time I go by it, I'm like, ha. I'm like Beavis and Butthead. I'm like, they said entering.
The dumb joke I used to tell that drive my wife crazy when we were driving, when we used to live in New York and we'd drive back to Rhode Island, there's a town in Connecticut, I think, it's called Wickaboxit.
I think I heard of it, yeah.
So I was always like in a Rhode Island accent, I'd be like, what do I do with all this potpourri? I guess I'll Wickaboxit. Put it in a Wickabox. Yeah, that's more of a laugh than I'd ever gotten.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm laughing at my own stupid jokes, so I'll
yeah. Laugh at yours. Why not laugh at my stupid jokes too?
Yeah, all right, why not?
All right, folks. So if you like what you hear, which is very doubtful at this point,
if you like our comedy styling,
yeah, it's not just a comedy show. It's just the comedy is a byproduct of all this talk about Deep Purple you've heard so far. Mm. You can support the show by subscribing an Apple Podcast, writing us a 5-star review. Tell us why you love the show. 5, please. 4 is good, too. If you also want to support the show, you can become a patron on Patreon for as little as $1 a month and join the Hall of Heroes. At the $5 a month tier, we have Clay Wambacher and Steve Seaborg of NameOnAnything.com and AllTheWorldsAstage.net. At the $3 tier, Peter Gardeau and Ian DeRosier. And at the $1 tier, Elle's Murders and Spacey Noodles. So for the $1 tier, you can join the Fake Name Club and you know, come up with a cool name. I don't know. Elle's Murders and Spacey Noodles are pretty cool. I don't know if anyone really has the creativity to come up with anything that cool and donate $1 a month. So that's the challenge we're going to throw out to you. Big thanks to our brothers of the Deep Dive Podcast Network, Riot Sabbath Bloody Podcast, who's doing his Under the Influence series, where he's diving into the careers of each of the four individual original members of Black Sabbath before he covers the last album, almost at the end of the run of his show. So that's going to be sad when it ends.
I haven't heard all of them yet, but I love those like Under the Influence episodes. They're really cool.
Yeah, really good stuff.
Yeah, I've listened to the Bill Ward one last, and I love how he keeps calling him Nibby.
Nibby. Well, he's got that one quote he plays in one of his in several of his episodes where it's Ozzy talking about how he got the name Nibby. And it doesn't answer any questions for me. He's like, oh, I saw him. And he looked like a, I said, hey, you look like a pen nib. I'm like, I don't know what that means, but it sure makes sense to Ozzy. What's a pen nib?
I don't know. The nib of a pen?
Like, yeah, maybe like the end of a pen. Nib, what's pen. A nib is the part of a quill dip pen or stylus which comes into contact with the writing surface. What does he have, like a pointy head? I don't know.
Well, Ozzy used to do a lot of drugs. Maybe he just, maybe he was on something. He's like, hey, that guy looks like a pen, you know?
or maybe Bill Ward did so much drugs that his head got pointy. I never heard of that being a thing. But
yeah, but back in those days, he looked pretty badass, you know? The John Bonham thing going on, the long hair and the mustache and beard, really thin, you know?
Like, yeah.
I don't know. Well, anyway, I like the way that he says it on his show, though. He just is like, so Nibby. You know, he's just like, and I'm like, why he keeps calling him Nibby? It's kind of funny.
He talks about all of them like they're old friends, too, which is kind of cool. Kind of like us. Yeah. Like, he'll rag on them and everything. And just like us, it comes from a great, great place. Yeah. So The Simple Man at Skinnerd Reconsidered, the Skinnerd Reconsidered podcast, a fantastic podcast. He's in between seasons right now, getting ready to dive into the Street Survivors album, which is their fourth studio album, and Give Me Back My Bullets, I think is the fourth one. I don't know anything about Lynyrd Skynyrd that I didn't learn from that show, so I'm kind of looking into it right now. And then the chairman of the Deep Dive Podcast Network, Terry T-Bone Mathley at T-Bone's Prime Cuts, and of course the patron saint and archivist of the Deep Purple Podcast, Jörg Planer, for all of his help in every episode and in between episodes. We really appreciate it. So some comments from social media. The Strange Brew podcast, I'll put a link in the show notes, did an interview with Howie Casey, which came out the exact same day that our episode on Paice, Ash, and Lord came out. And that's significant because Howie Casey did the horn arrangements and everything on Paice, Ash, and Lord. So when we saw that the morning that the episode came out, I eagerly, quickly posted on, like, right under his thing. I was like, hey, we just had an episode with him come out today. And then I was like, oh crap. I was like, I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to hijack your post. And he's like, no, it's great. So now we got a new friend. So it's a pretty cool podcast. He's got a good interview with him. Another thing that came out is, have you seen this account? Come taste the memes that I've been tagging you in.
Yeah. It's great. I've only seen a couple since yesterday, but, it's pretty weird.
I love it. It's really weird, but I love it. Follow it on Instagram. So basically he's got the meme of the guy with his girlfriend looking the other way at the other girl, and he's got, you know, he's holding hands with Ritchie Blackmore, but Glenn Hughes is looking at Tommy Bolin as he walks by. And then he's got another one, it's the exact same meme, but it's Ritchie Blackmore holding hands with David Coverdale and then looking at Ronnie James Dio.
I just like how poorly edited the pictures are. It's especially the Tommy Bolin one.
It's absolutely terrible. It's great. And the look on Richie's face, though, looking back at Ronnie James Dio, is
great. Yeah, he's just kind of like, you know, which is, you know, typical Richie. Look, I like Coverdale. He looks all pithy. He's like,
I think it's the perfect meme for Blackmore, because he's always got like some new singer that is like the new thing, and he's sick of the old one already. It's great. But yeah, definitely check it out. The account's only been around for like, I don't know, a week or two.
It's fun.
But so far, it's just a lot of fun, because how many other Deep Purple specific meme accounts are there? Not a ton.
And we're not talking about Coverdale either.
Exactly. Yeah, he's kind of a Deep Purple. Yeah, his memes aren't about Deep Purple, but he is Deep Purple related.
Yeah.
Got this other account, Riding the Meme Out, another meme account, who said, hey, I just finished your teaser episode and enjoyed it a lot, and I just wanted to say I love your show and appreciate the work you guys do for your podcast. So that's great. Appreciate the support. Sweet. And then Rich on Facebook says, hey, just stumbled across your podcast. So far, so good. I realize that it sounds like an insult, but I like that you are not experts. There's a charm to listening to two good friends discuss the music they love and discovering slash rediscovering the music of Deep Purple, as well as their story. So it's great. It's great to get that sort of feedback. We really appreciate it.
And thank you for not calling us experts, because we know we're not.
Yes. And yeah, we've had, and it's been great. We've had very little of that so far where people are like, you got this wrong. You got that wrong. A little bit of it, but very, very much less than I thought we'd get. It's usually people that are much more well-read than us complimenting us, which is great.
Yeah, but you also, like, you've said it like a bunch of times when we first started, is we don't claim to be like experts or have an in with the band or anything. It's just our you know, thing. It's just our opinions.
Now, if I had an in with the band, maybe I would have got to meet him at the concert.
Oh, no, that's right. I'm sorry. Bad memories.
It would have been nice to have an in with the band. Hopefully next time they come around, we'll be like best friends with all of them. Maybe we could even meet Ian Gillan, even though he doesn't do the meet and greets. So I talked in the last episode about Mo Foster's amazing book, British Rock Guitar, and he does this little talk, and I just really want to talk up this book because, like I talked about in the last episode, it's an outstanding book. As I continue to read it, and just it's just filled with story after story after story, all these funny stories and cool stories. And one of the things that they really talk about is how there was no like necessarily standard for guitars back then, and I'm going to play a little snippet because I did get the audio here to play to promote this book. You really should get it if you have any interest in this subject matter. Or this is Mo Foster interviewing and putting quotes and stories from every musician under the sun that you could possibly think of. So guaranteed there's going to be dozens of musicians in there that you love telling cool stories. So let me see. I'm trying to think of a good one to play here. There's quite a few. Some of them are related to music. Some of them aren't. But they're but they're all funny little 30 to 45 second stories that he tells. He tells us one story of, you know, like talking about how the gear wasn't really there. How he had a guitar and he made a pickup by somehow splicing in some headphones into a soap dish and putting that under his strings, and that somehow he plugged that into a speaker and was able to get sound out of it. And again, the stuff we take for granted is that we just get a store-bought, even the cheapest store-bought guitar or $50 guitar from Amazon is ready to go. But back then they had to kind of work with it. Maybe I'll tell you about this one here about, which kind of illustrates that, which is him talking about, give me one second here. This is him talking about the early days of, the guitar, not really knowing what to do with the plug. So let me share this audio with you. Let's try this. Oh, wait.
The electric guitar, we all take it for granted now, but in the very early days, no one had a clue what it meant or how it worked. And you often saw in the media, they thought it plugged in the wall like this. No one knew about amplifiers. They were just existed. Francis Rossi of Status Quo, he got an electric guitar in a case, and it came with all bits and pieces, one of which was the jack-to-jack lead. And he thought, that can't be right. So he took off one plug, put on our 13 amp. He said, I thought it needed time to warm up. I don't know how people didn't kill themselves.
So the guy just plugs the guitar straight into the, he rigs up an electric plug onto it, plugs it into the wall, and just thought it needed time to warm up. I don't know where they thought the sound was going to come out of. That's great. And then he's got a good one. It's one more story here. I'm trying to see. he tells us. The story has nothing to do with anything, but he tells a story about one of his friends. I got to play this story because it's great. It doesn't have to do with music, but it's just a really funny one. It's very short.
Ronnie's, I'm sure you've been to the club. Well, my first band, Affinity, we were signed to Ronnie, he was our manager, and our first gig there was supporting Stan Getz, which is fantastic. And the downside was carrying a Hammond organ in every bloody night, carrying it up the stairs. Bad news. Ronnie, I did like him, he was a kind of mentor, showed you could play beautiful music and have a good laugh at the same time. I think my favourite story is of Ronnie's surrealism. he's talking, you know, I mentioned earlier on the austerity of the post-war thing. He said it, his mum used to buy school clothes at the Army and Navy stores. I don't know if you remember the Army and Navy stores. He said it wasn't easy for a 10-year-old Jewish kid from the East End having to go to school dressed as a Japanese admiral.
He's got a really great delivery, so yeah.
it's like he could be a comedian or something.
No, he's great. And then one more. This is about Ron Asprey, who did the horn arrangements on both, I believe, the Coverdale Whitesnake album, as well as Glenn Hughes's Play Me Out. Mm-hmm. And this is a really quick one, but I gotta hear this one.
My favorite musician observations are the survival ones, because we all have to survive against this mad world where people don't understand what musicians are or what they do. Ronnie Asprey, the late Ronnie Asprey, the sax player, was in his car one day going down Park Lane at 5 o'clock to get home to Brighton. And he was stuck, and he thought he'd move into the bus lane, which is the daftest thing you could do. And within seconds, he's totally boxed in, right next to a policeman on the pavement who comes over. On the window. This was a new car, and Ronnie couldn't find the controls, so the first thing that happens is the windscreen wiper starts fighting away to try. Finally gets the window open, and this policeman has that humour that some police have, that they think is amusing but isn't. He said, "Is this a bus, sir?" And Ronnie looked at him and said, "You're new on traffic, aren't you?"
Anyway, if you like those stories, check out his book. It's loaded with stories like that. It's a combination of, you know, funny stories like that and just a lot of like really technical stories about the technical, especially the beginning of the book, the technical stories about like plugging a guitar into the wall, waiting for it to warm up, things like that when they didn't really know what they were doing. Building, like I think I talked about the last episode, building a bass out of like an upright bass and plugging it into like a banjo or whatever, just the crazy things that they would do to make their own instruments. Anyway, yeah, definitely check out that book. He also, Mo sent me an email a few days ago and he just said, "Hey Nate, I have a quick story for you. Some years ago, I had a call from Roger Glover, who was visiting London. He fancied popping over for a cup of tea and a chat. Just before he'd rung, my wife Kay, a New Zealander and a big Purple fan, had gone for a long walk on a very soggy Hampstead Heath. When she returned home a couple of hours later, sweaty and with her boots and clothes covered in mud, she came into the room where we were sitting, and I introduced them. 'Kay, this is Roger.' The expression on her face was priceless. Cheers, Mo." So his wife, who's a huge Deep Purple fan, wasn't expecting to meet a member of Deep Purple that day, comes home all muddy and face-to-face with Roger Glover. I told him that I'd be happy to meet Roger Glover in any state possible, or any of them for that matter. Got a great video. I'll put a link in the show notes from Jorg, which is, we talked about wondering what Deep Purple played when George Harrison jumped on stage with them. Mm. Well, they played Lucille. And there's a video of it. It's got like 8-minute long video. We also talked about kind of can't imagine Ritchie sharing the stage with another guitarist. And I can't think of another video from anything later than, say, 1965 of him on stage with another guitar player. So it's very interesting. Of course, he's not going to make too much. He didn't try to hit George Harrison for being on part of the stage. But it's actually kind of a weird video because you see them kind of all crammed on Richie's part of the stage. And you're just like, you're getting tense. You're like, oh, my God, he's going to hit George Harrison.
That would have been funny.
But it's kind of cool hearing, hearing those two things kind of combine. And then another really interesting note I got from Jorg Planer, we'll eventually get into today's episode. Jorg, you had mentioned on the Paice, Ash and Lord episode how you were like, man, I wish we could hear Coverdale singing these songs. Well, apparently for the second album that they were starting to record, that was a consideration. They were in talks with Coverdale to be the vocalist for those songs. And the funny thing is, so you know, it's Paice, Ash and Lord, PAL. Well, Coverdale decided to call it Clap. Coverdale, Lord, Ashton, and Pace. Of course, he has some way of making that into a dirty reference. But it never came to be, sort of. But then when I was thinking about it, I was like, well, it's kind of just Whitesnake at that point. You've got Coverdale, yeah. Pace, Ashton, Marsden. Lord, Marsden, Ashton would not be there. But that would have been something. Imagine the second album like that.
Yeah.
But, I mean,
we can only imagine.
We have the first Coverdale album. It's not too far off. It's great.
Yep, it is none too shabby.
Nope. And then finally, some more Facebook feedback about our teaser episode. Frank writes in and says, what a great episode. I'm so glad I found your podcast. It takes me back to the time in the late 90s when me and my friends got into Purple and suddenly found all these fantastic side projects, solo stuff, and the Purple family. I absolutely love Teaser. It was great to hear your thoughts about the songs. Looking forward to diving into another episode.
Nice.
That's great. Yeah. So, yeah, and there's probably stuff I'm leaving. At this point, I have to leave some, you know, when we first started doing the show, we're like, I'm going to read every comment we got because we got like three, but now we're getting so many, I have to leave them out. Mm. But I should probably leave more out, but it's just exciting to hear all these people saying these great things. All right. So here we are, Ian Gillan Band. I can't believe we're actually here. The Ian Gillan Band.
Yeah.
We're going to have to.
I had nothing to add.
I was just trying to, my throat's dry, so I was trying to take a sip. But yeah. Ian Gillan Band. So some quick history. So after Gillan leaves Deep Purple, he gets into a number of financial or investments, I should say, or business ventures, whatever you want to call them. So he had this accountant, Bill Reed, who handled all the accountants, for like Deep Purple and all the guys. He basically took all their money, put it on offshore accounts and everything, you know, all above board to try to make the money. But apparently he had this very elaborate network for where the money was and how to get it and blah, 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 blah. And then he died suddenly after this. But yeah, so with him died all the information as to how to access these accounts and get the money. So I think a lot of the money was lost, unfortunately, in that. You get that from Ian Gillan's Child in Time book. So Gillan had decided at this point he's never going to sing again. He's going into this new phase of his life, and he wanted to figure out a way to make money. He cut his hair short. He wanted to dress more normal, be more of a businessman. He bought this hotel for about £100,000 in cash. And decided and put about 300,000 additional pounds into it to renovate it and get it ready. And what he wanted to do is open what he said, the finest country hotel in the world. They had this huge opening party on November 30th, 1974. And like basically he invited like the whole village, like there were people there that were like, oh, we don't want a rock star there. There's going to be like orgies and drinking and all this. So he basically invited everyone from this village or whatever there. And like basically everyone came and it was just like this epic party. And then after that, no one gave him any trouble because I guess he gave him enough free drinks or whatever. Mm-hmm. He had that going on. The other one was he started to get interested in motorcycles. A friend of his was doing like a motorcycle race. He went to see it. He got really excited about the prospect of motorcycles. He decided, I'm going to open my own motorcycle shop called World of Wheels. In September of 1975, he opened that up. And basically at this time, there was a bit of a bubble for motorcycles. And there was a big, big bubble. It popped. And he lost a ton of money on that deal. So from then on, things started to get a little worse for him financially. So Martin Birch came to Gillan and says, hey, Delane Lee Studios is up for sale. They're moving to a new location, but they've left all the old equipment behind and the studio's up for sale. I can be there. I'll be your recording engineer. Everything will be great. So Gillan said, oh, cool. I could have my own recording studio. So he buys the studio, and then 4 days later Martin Birch comes to him and says, hey, Deep Purple, I'm really sorry, but Deep Purple just offered me to put me on retainer and go with them, so I can't do the studio with you anymore. I've just gotten married. It's too good an opportunity to turn down. So he lost Martin Birch as his main guy, and he didn't really have any other qualified people. Glover mostly stepped in and used the studio a lot for his projects, but he lost Martin Birch. And then, of course, this is when Butterfly Ball happens. He does the live show and gets realizes, oh, maybe I could sing at this point. Bill Reed calls him up and says, hey, your things are falling apart. You've bought a recording studio. You've bought a motorcycle company. You've done all this stuff, and you're really in a lot of trouble. So Gillan tells a story in his book about he told one of his friends to go fill up his car with gas because he had an account at this gas station. His friend goes to fill it up, and the guy comes running out and saying, don't put any gas in that car. It's Ian Gillan's car. He's bankrupt. And he's completely out of money. So he got no money. So that was pretty much the financial lead up to this. But at the Butterfly Ball, he meets, I'm sure he probably knew them before, but he meets Mike Moran, he meets John Gustafson, he meets Ray Fenwick, and all of them together decide to form a band with Mark Nosif on percussion. So we've covered Gillan, obviously. We've covered Fenwick tons on the Butterfly Ball episodes. We covered Gustafson. We covered Mike Moran. The only person we haven't really talked about is Mark Nosif, who's from New York. He had performed with Elf and the Velvet Underground, and he'd go on to work with Thin Lizzy, Phil Lynott, Gary Moore, and he was also part of the Wizards Convention. So that's a little bit of background on him. All right, so then the lead up to the album, there's a lot of good information in Dave Thompson's Smoke on the Water book. And the thing that strikes me the most is that Ian Gillan wanted to call this, or they wanted to call this band Shand Grenade, which I think is a terrible name.
Well, they didn't go with it.
Yeah, what it is it's basically a portmanteau of Shangri-La and Hand Grenade. So I don't know what the significance of that is. If it's like, oh, it's this idyllic, wonderful utopia and something that can blow you up. I don't know if they're trying to be like that juxtaposition. At any rate, I think it's a pretty terrible name. And I think basically some record executive somewhere was like, what are you, stupid? You're Ian Gillan. Use the call name Ian Gillan band.
Call it Ian Gillan.
Yeah, yeah. Do you want to sell records? Then go as Ian Gillan. People know who you are. Shand Grenade's a terrible name. I don't have anything to back that up. That's just my guess. I'm sure it's pretty accurate. So they formed this band. They made their debut just before Christmas, 1975, on German TV with Roger Glover on bass and Mickey Lee Soul on keyboards. And they did a few shows like that. And then before Gustafson and eventually Mickey Lee Soul was replaced. Mickey Lee Soul was just doing it as kind of a stopgap. He was never really intended, I don't think, to be in the band. So they recorded at Musicland Studios with Roger producing. And again, that's Musicland in Munich, where they did Stormbringer and where David Coverdale did his album, where they did Paice, Ashe & Lord. And apparently they got there. They landed in Munich and were immediately arrested because they had made a huge ruckus on the plane. Apparently this band was completely out of control. When you see the later band Gillan, when you look at them, they look like they'd be a real problem, but apparently Ian Gillan band was even crazier. Gillan describes the music as they were making as now sort of music at the time, trying to do something a little different. They began recording in January of 1976, just 3 months after his Butterfly Ball performance. Gillan decided not to use Coletta's management. He goes into a big thing in the book about how Coletta is a, you know, kind of a what he is. He was just basically like, yeah, sure, I'll sign you, but you got to give me 100% of everything and rights to all the songs. And he had these crazy stipulations, and Gillan was like, no, I'm not interested. He tells this story about how they made friends with this group of hookers in the hotel who would be hanging out there. And then he said, there's this really weird story in there basically about how the hookers were hanging out in the hotel, and there was like this short, fat guy with a cigar who was probably just some rich guy who was maybe hiring them. And Ray Fenwick went over for some reason and decided to drop his pants and sat in this big plate of like canapes that was there that they were eating. I don't know why he did this, if he was drunk, if he was just trying to be an a-hole. But Gillan says in his book, quote, Ray has one of the hairiest arses in the world. He said when he stood up, there were bits of cucumber and carrot and everything stuck to his ass. And then Gillan says the man just basically with the cigar had no reaction. All he did was take his lit cigar and then stick it on Ray's ass. causing probably much discomfort. I don't know if it's on his ass or in his ass. I'd like to think it's on, because that would be pretty painful. And he says, basically, Gillan says they were pretty much, by the time they got to America to tour, the band was completely out of control, and he started traveling separately because they were just all doing wild, crazy things like this.
Jeez.
Yeah, it's really interesting. He tells a story too of they had some like reporter that had come to visit them to talk to them, and Gillan looked over and Johnny Gustafsson was just pissing in this woman's handbag, and then he threw it out the window. Like, I don't know why. I mean, this is a reporter that was reporting them about the album, but he just decided to just do that. I guess just crazy rock and roll antics in the 70s.
Jesus.
You hear all the stories about Zeppelin, I guess you have to one up them or whatever. But that's just kind of the lead up to where we are coming into this album here. And a cover of the album art, we've got the cover here. It's kind of a weird cover. It's not the best cover for I'd say it comes in third place of the three Ian Gillan Band album covers.
Yeah.
How would you even describe what's going on in this album?
It's like a creepy girl doll in a prism, mm-hmm. holding a dog in a box on this leash.
Yep.
That's, and then Child in Time spelled out in like little like blocks.
It kind of comes back like to that Gillan directness we've talked about before, or is just like, you know, the song. Oh, what should we call this song? Prostitute. You know, like here it is like Child in Time. Well, write it in. It's about a child, so have a child on the cover and write it in little baby blocks, like letter blocks or something. It's a little weird.
I think it's kind of funny that he went with that, like that Deep Purple song, as like doing like another version of it, and then calling his album the same thing.
Yeah, that is definitely an odd thing. And I wasn't really super familiar. I was very Clear Air Turbulence is one of my maybe top 10 albums of all time. Love it. And I listened to that, and I never really, you know how back in the day it was just a little different. You would, when it was just CDs or physical media. For some reason, this album just never popped up for me, and I didn't really get into it until very recently when you were like, "Hey, you should listen to that because it's got a cool version of Child in Time." But this one just kind of always escaped me. I don't know why I didn't complete it out, but I had Clearer Turbulence, I had Scarabus, and I just never had this one.
I think this one, I found out about it later. Like, I didn't even know that this was part of the Ian Gillan Band albums. I think that was why.
Yeah, might have been.
Like, I mean, at the time, I can't remember when I discovered it, but I just remember thinking like this was like the unknown album to me. I was just like, oh, there's another one. And then it was like, you know, I had to get it. It was like the, you know, the jewel of the collection, so to speak.
Yeah, I was very, I think it was, God, within the last year that you told me about it. And I was like, how did I miss this one? And I think it was just the confusion, because there's Ian Gillan Band, and then there's Gillan, and then there's even things he does as Ian Gillan.
Yeah. So there's like he had three different things under his name, pretty much.
Is that little girl holding a gun?
I think so. Is there a way to zoom in? I think it is a gun, yeah.
I am leaning into the thing.
I think,
it looks like she's holding a gun. That makes it even creepier.
Well, if you think of like, you know, they're taking things literally, see the bullets flying.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
So
see, the dog's just flying is more like it. That dog is like flying behind her.
Like, do you even know like whether, I don't get any of this album cover.
No, it's very weird. Yeah, she's like you said, she's in like a weird, like clear pyramid, but that's like very, very crudely drawn, and then it's like the dog is floating in a glass cube behind her.
I mean, it's very Ian Gillan, you know. He's just very kind of a quirky, doesn't really, yeah, he never does the obvious. That's what I think.
Yeah, this is true.
Left to his own devices. So I think
so the photography for this album cover was done by Paul Wakefield, who did some work for Rick Wakeman and also Supertramp. And you've got the back cover, which is just, it's like a weird nude figure doing like a little sort of yoga sitting cross-legged, kind of yoga. And it's just a black background in the very top corner, this little like nude figure sitting cross-legged. And then there's the, it just says, side one lists the songs, side two lists the songs. And then at the very, very, it's like 98% blackness. And at the bottom is just some copyright stuff. So it's kind of a, they did not spend a ton of time worrying about the back cover.
No. Nope.
The interior gatefold kind of takes that letter block theme and then just has pictures of the band members. Some of them are solo pictures. Some of them are groups of anywhere between three and five of them. And then with each one on the side written all kind of higgledy-piggledy or all the different lyrics for the songs.
It's pretty cool.
So yeah, it's probably cooler than the cover, to be honest. There's apparently also a lyric sheet insert. And then the record itself, 1976, has all the information on it. So that's the art for Child in Time, something a little different. The photography on the inside was done by Joe Gaffney, who did photography for Badfinger and Uriah Heep. The design is by Dan Fern, who did albums for a few other bands, including Small Faces. So, stuff to look at there. It was recorded, like I said, at Music Land. It was mixed at Mountain Studios, which is a studio that's in the mountains of Switzerland in Montreux. And then it was produced by Roger Glover, and he also did some of the synthesizer and vocals on it as well. So that's
nice. Another production by Roger Glover.
Another Roger. We're deep into Roger Glover production territory here on the show.
Another Gillan Glover joint.
Another exactly. So that's it. We're that's the album. Are we ready to dive into the tracks?
The tracks. Yes. Yeah.
So the first track up is called "Lay Me Down." This track is written by Gillan, Fenwick, Nazif, and Gustafsson. So Mike Moran was the only one that didn't participate in the writing of this. And here we go. It's called "Lay Me Down." Great little opening riff.
Yeah.
You can raise the volume a little bit on this.
Yeah, you could raise it just a little bit.
It's coming in a little cold. So it kind of starts with a very standard kind of rock and riff, and goes into this percussive vocal section. Something a little bit out of left field.
I like the combo of like just the guitar, the bass, Gillan's vocals. It's all like really just rocking.
Yes.
I like the bass.
Mark Nazif is a huge percussion guy, so you've got a lot of percussion stuff going on here.
I like the bass.
Yeah, Gustafsson is really doing an amazing job. It's a great organ solo here too.
Yeah, we got a nice, like, John Lord-ish organ solo going on.
And I like how it crosses over into the chorus, too. It doesn't just stay in the first part.
Yeah, great chord change.
Heavy on the shaker there in the right channel.
Oh, yeah.
Like, Gillan's really raw on this, too. He's like, sounding like he's straining his voice, almost like on purpose, you know? Like kind of the John Lennon twist and shout thing, where it's the last song he recorded after 12 hours, so his voice is shot. And, But it's but in a good way, you know?
Yeah.
Ray Fenwick doing a little slide solo there.
That's some good stuff right there.
Yeah, kind of a really short album opener. In the credits of the album, you hear Fenwick doing that slide guitar at the end. This is one of those albums where they were credited everybody as doing, they credit everyone as doing everything. So like, Fenwick is guitar, slide guitar. Well, yeah, it's the same guitar.
It's like then, steel guitar, like fretless guitar.
Like the Glenn Hughes one, it was like, he plays piano, keyboards, Fender Rhodes piano, organ, synthesizer. It's like, yes, anything with keys, we get it. Same thing here. And it's got the list from Mark Nossi, as far as, because he's such a percussion guy, is drums, marimba, bells, tubular and various, triangle, steel drums, drum, African log, flexitone, darabuco, which I've never heard of, African thunder sheet, odaiko, various shakers, kabasa, claves, gong, congas, bongos, finger cymbals, temple block, gong, rototoms, cymbals, cymbal tree, bell tree, guero, and a go-go. It's like, wow, they didn't leave anything out.
Well,
if I hear a vibra slap in there, I'm gonna be like, hey, you didn't list that.
Well, I gotta tell you, if I knew how to play all that, I'd be bragging about it.
Yeah, I guess so. Right?
So I mean, I guess you just let them have it.
Oh boy. Yeah, so that's pretty making a pretty bold statement there right off the bat in the album. It's a very short album. Playtime wise, seven songs.
Yeah, seven. I was kind of surprised to see that when I looked. I was like, oh, only seven tracks. I forgot.
Yeah, when you're like listening to it in the car or whatever, you're not really thinking about where the tracks begin and end. But I kind of felt like there was more to it than that. But what do you think of Lay Me Down?
I like it. I think it's like, it's definitely like a very, very Ian Gillan, but it's like, it's almost like Gillan trying to do his take on like a rock and purple song.
Yeah.
Like it's got a lot of purple elements in it, but like even from like the opening riff, you can be like, yeah, this is like classic, like Ian Gillan, like it's got his stamp all over it. So, but I think it's, the playing is good and the music and everything. Like I enjoy it. So if I can figure out how to work this thing, I'm going to give it a four creepy dolls.
Four dolls trapped in prisms.
Yeah, I'm gonna give it four creepy dolls.
I'll also give it four. I really, really like that track, and I'm gonna struggle on this episode not to compare everything to Clear Air Turbulence, because that's the one that I definitely have listened to the most, know the most, and definitely can't wait for. But it feels like to me like this is something that we'll get into when we get into the reviews and everything. Part of what this was the natural transition of Gillan doing something new, doing something different, not just, and like we've talked about before, people just like want to hear Machine Head again, you know, they want every album to be Machine Head, and that's not what you're getting here. You're getting something that's showing Gillan's solo style, which to this point nobody had heard, because the Sher Kazoo stuff, A, doesn't really show it, and B, it was never released until the 90s. So this is getting their first taste of Gillan post Deep Purple. And I got to say that track comes out and makes a pretty good statement.
Yeah.
All right, next track is a song we have heard before, just not this version of it. And that song is You Make Me Feel So Good. So we've heard the Sher Kazoo version. Starts with a little fade in of the percussion.
All that percussion that they listed.
Playing the water temple or whatever, the water gong, all these crazy thunder sheet.
I like that one.
Sounds good.
That alone sounds like a band name. What is it? Now performing Thunder Sheet.
This kind of surprised me the first time I heard this song, because I was familiar with the Sher Kazoo version, so, which is not far off of it. doesn't do that. There's a little riff that goes into it on the shirt. It's just a standard Gillan song about making sweet, sweet love.
It's got a nice groove.
Yep. You get this really low in the background.
Yeah, this is a little quirkier than other versions. I prefer the heavier version of it.
Yeah. Doesn't he do one with Gillan as well?
Yeah. Yeah, he's got like a really heavy version of this.
I can't tell who's doing that other vocal here.
Yeah, this one just got a little weird.
it's like Ian Gillan alone in the bedroom with a woman. It's like, wait, who are these other guys? What a great scream in there.
You know, I'm always going to give that a thumbs up.
Yeah, it's hard to not love a classic Gillan scream.
The album is like really bass heavy, which is not a bad thing, but the bass is very prominent and the guitar just seems to kind of be in the background, you know?
You mean bass as far as the instrument, right? Not like the EQ?
Bass guitar, yeah.
Yeah, I think Gustafsson's playing is incredible and on clearer turbulence and his bass is out of control. Especially on the first track, and you really get to hear it very clearly. When it might blend in on some other albums. But it's another fairly short song. It's only clocking in at 3:44, and you had like a 30-second fade-in of the percussion beforehand, so it's a pretty short song overall.
Yeah.
But what do you think about You Make Me Feel So Good?
It makes me feel okay. It's hard not to compare it with the heavier versions of the song that I've heard before.
And I don't know that I know the heavier versions as well as you might. I'm very familiar with the Cher Kazoo version.
Yeah. Which I'm going to give it like three creepy dolls because I just think it's like, it's okay. Like, I guess I can't not know that there's like a better version of the song that I like better. Plus it's like, you know how I feel about Gillan's quirkiness. Like here, it just doesn't really do it for me. It's like, I always want the song to get into that heavier chugging territory and it never quite gets there. So it kind of leaves me wanting a little bit.
Yeah, I agree. I'm going to go with a three as well.
But you know, his like scream like after the solo like gets like a five.
Yeah, fantastic. And if but like you said, like the tempo is very slow, and I really do miss that like that he does on the other stories, Cher Kazoo version. Yeah. Of it. They just don't do anything during this one, so it feels like to me I'm used to that version, so it kind of feels like it's missing out on something.
Yeah,
and this version was written by Gillan, Moran, Dave Wintour, Bernie Holland, and Andy Steele, because this again was from a previous sessions that he brought into this to this album. Okay, next song up we have is a song called Shame. My album mark's just really tiny all the time. Hitting with that little off tempo, the upbeat. Very cool. I really love what Mark Noziev does on this album. synth patch they're doing in there, that little harp. That's really nice. Very strange. This part's really strange, but I really dig it.
I can definitely appreciate all the different stuff that the instruments are doing, though.
Yes.
Like, all the individual parts, like the drum parts, the bass, like, they're all very, like, they're all doing their own thing. They're all doing some cool stuff.
And the song isn't even 3 minutes long, but yet they kind of work in this little interlude here, which is kind of cool.
I feel like this song could have been on Coverdale's first album.
Yeah, yeah, I think the instrumentation might have been a little different, but it's got that kind of feel to it.
Yeah, not this part, but like
the
chorus and the bridge part make me think of like something off Coverdale's White Snake album. Like this right here. I don't know which song, but
I love it.
I
don't know what about it I like, but it's great. That's it. Just such a short little, less than 3 minutes long, but there's so much going on in that song. So many parts. It's such an interesting arrangement. Just very non-standard. This isn't just like, oh, they must have written this to try to be the single or get on the radio. This was something that they wrote, who knows why, but it's just very, I just really appreciate what they were doing with the song when they made it.
Yes, well, while I did as well, I'm still giving it a 3.
A 3, really? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I do agree that, like, it's definitely interesting, and they packed a lot of cool stuff in there, including kind of that, like kind of instrumental, I don't know if you call it a breakdown, but like that kind of instrumental piece in the middle. And it was very like, you can tell that it was thought out, but it also sounds like it wasn't really going anywhere.
Yeah.
At the same time, plus like, and this is just like my personal preference, but kind of the lack of guitar on the song so far is like kind of bumming me out, you know, because it's like, it's not, I don't know. I just want more guitar. Like, I'm more of like a chunky riffs type of guy, you know? And I mean, the guitar's doing some cool stuff, but it's not present enough, maybe in the mix or.
Right. And Fenwick is more of like an ensemble player than Blackmore, who's going to demand being higher up in the mix and being more in everybody's face.
But I would say that I could even like, you know, I could even let that go if like the songs were like kind of did more for me too, but that doesn't mean that I don't think that the music or the playing is good, because it is good.
I feel like every time I hear this song, when it starts off, I'm like, ugh, this song. And then by the end of it, I'm like, oh yeah, I really like that, because it keeps taking you back and forth. And when you've got that little arp thing where, I don't know if it's an arp, but assuming it's that kind of like, I don't know what you call that kind of patch on a synth. We've got Joe. I don't know. I don't know what you call it, but it's. I've worked with synths that do that before. Do that. Like I like playing synths, but I have no idea what the knobs do. And I know when I hear that, I'm like, yeah, I like that. I don't know what it's called.
Yeah.
And it's really. I really dig it. I'm gonna give it a 3.5 because I appreciate the different places that song takes you.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway. All right, so we got our next track up. is going to be a track called Down the Road. Let me figure this out. I'm trying to fix my album art situation here. All right, Down the Road. And this one is written by... The last track was written by Gillan, Fenwick, Nozzy, and Gustafsson. This one is... Oh, wait, am I doing it wrong? I skipped a song. I'm sorry. Abort! Abort! I skipped My Baby Loves Me.
Whoops.
Oh, my goodness. What a faux pas. This has never happened before on the Deep Purple podcast. I apologize. I'm really... I failed. I failed you all today.
Somebody's getting rusty over here.
I know, right? Rusty.
Just get out that big cane. Yank him.
Rusty, like the horse, the war horse. My Baby Loves Me. This is written by Gillan, Fenwick, Nozif, and Glover. So here we go. Promising beginning there. You listen to the lyrics of the song, it sounds like a standard blues song. But the instrumentation is anything but.
Yeah, I like how this is like a blues-based song, but it's done very Gillan-esque. It's the full Gillan treatment.
Yep.
Just really interesting percussion. The kind of... kind of rhythm. I'm enjoying this.
Fenwick is not getting enough credit. That little swelling pad that comes in there. Song could so easily have been one of those terrible, boring blues filler songs.
Place in line!
With different instrumentation.
Yeah, but there's a lot of cool, interesting stuff going on here.
Oh, yeah. And it's kind of the hallmark of the Ian Gillan band, is they're instrumentation-wise, and vocally, of course, there's always a ton going on. It's never boring. It's always really... intricately planned out. Now you hear that, like, I don't even know if you could hear that in the podcast or in your earphone, but this, he does this big scream that's like right at the very end of the fade out. But really good stuff.
I think I might have missed it.
Yeah, it's really down there in the mix. Next time, crank it up right at the end.
Oh yeah, baby.
All right, My Baby Loves Me.
And I love it, 3.5.
Yeah, I'll give that a 3.5 as well.
I love it, 3.5. I think it's good. I mean, now I'm starting to see like a pattern in the album, you know, just kind of like, you know, these really kind of off kilter beats, you know, some cool percussion work, you know, just really different type of stuff. Like, you know, you can tell, like, if you know all the Ian Gillan albums, you know that this is the type of stuff that he does. It's just this really kind of like, you know, offbeat type of stuff. And, you know, it's like, this one I liked because there was like some good guitar presence in it. You know, Gillan's vocals were good. Mm-hmm. You know, it was just like not processed. Like, I love it when he doubles his vocals, like on the first few songs, but I also love it too when he just like has that simple, like, kind of echo or reverb on it, because he was just like, you know, that's when he was in his prime. So he sounded great no matter what.
All right, next track up is the last. This will be the last track on the first side.
But wait a minute, what are you giving it? You didn't give it anything.
I'm sorry, I give it 3.5.
You really are losing it.
Sorry, I wrote it in the spreadsheet, but forgot to announce it to the world. 3.5, I say.
And also, did you forget the previous one?
Maybe I forgot to say it. Shame? No, I think I said it 3.5, right? Why are some of these bolded?
I don't know, but oh, there we go.
Yeah, 3.5.
Okay.
Last two for me are 3.5.
Okay.
All right. Next up, we have the track that I already played the first few seconds of, Down the Road. And this one,
whoops,
is written by Gillan, Fenwick, Nozick, Gustafsson, and Glover. Gustafsson singing that part?
Yeah, it's not Ian.
It sounds like Gustafsson. It's gotta be.
It sounds like he's doing a duet with somebody.
I love it. And when you think of Ian Gillan Band, you've got three incredible singers. Fenwick, Gustafsson, and Ian Gillan. My only criticism of the band is that they didn't do more of this. Mm. It's a very, like, soulful song. We've talked about this before, but this reminds me of one of those songs that with the 80s style production would have been one of those power ballads, like a Home Sweet Home or something.
Oh yeah.
Thank God it didn't have that production. This is a very well done backwards guitar solo.
Let me a good backwards guitar solo.
So easy to do poorly, but it's done well. Great harmonies on this part too.
I gotta be honest, it's not really doing it for me.
Not doing it for you?
Which is sad, because I want it to do it for me. I know.
What is it about it that's not doing it for you?
I don't know, I feel like there's a couple of songs on this album, and this is one of them, that it feels like it's not a fully realized idea for some reason.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, as much as I like the vocals, I don't know if like the duet vocals really work.
It's definitely, I mean, they took a chance on this one. It's very, it's out there.
I mean, I'll give it points for creativity and not doing things like everybody else. Like he could always have done just any run of the mill, you know, thing, but he didn't. Mm-hmm. You know, his whole band didn't. So, but I mean, you know, regardless, it's, you know, it's like, I'm thinking of it from the point of view is just like, you know, how does this make me feel? Would I want to go back and listen to it again type of thing. So, in that respect, I'm kind of disappointed. I'm gonna have to give this the dreaded 2.5.
Oh, whoa. Oh my goodness. You should have told me to sit down first.
Oh, sit down.
All right.
Do you want a cold compress? Yeah,
sorry, dude, you have more to say about?
No, just it leaves me kind of cold. It leaves me kind of wanting.
I'm gonna give it a 3.5. I dig what they're doing with it. I really like the harmonies that they all come in with. I like the back and forth between Gillan and presumably Gustafsson on that one. But yeah, it does feel like it could be like there's somewhere it doesn't go, you know?
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm still reeling from that 2.5. I don't think we've seen anything in the 2 range for a while.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I was thinking, I'm like, should I do that? And then I'm like, I'm not going to be nice just to be nice.
Oh, you got to do what you got to do, man. You got to go with your heart.
I didn't feel it in here.
So
where is it? Where's my heart over here?
There's some sort of feeling it evokes in me that I really like. Like it's, and I can't put my finger on it, but I can feel it as like the end to a side of an album and just kind of this like, oh, we're going to bring it down. I like the vibe of it. So
that's fair.
All right, so then we're going to start up the second album with the second album, did I say? Second side of the album. Mind is like, play Clearer Turbulence.
Gung Show, get out the cane, get rid of him.
Exactly. My brain just wants Clearer Turbulence, and I don't blame it. Mm. So yeah, the first song on the next side of the album is Child in Time. Like you've never heard it before. I can only imagine what this would have been like in their live set when people were like, oh, they're going to play Child in Time. Great.
Now, I got to say that I really love what they did with this version.
Well, this is what, like, it must have been about a year ago you were telling me. It was before we were doing the show. You were saying, oh, you've never heard the Child in Time from that album? I was like, no, I've never even heard of it. So I checked it out, and it's definitely different.
I think that it really, like, it retains, like, the feel of it, you know, the kind of otherworldly type of feel, but in a different way. And, like...
Yeah, but it couldn't sound any more different in the same time, you know?
But it's so good.
It is very good, and it's quite a bit shorter. Even we're about a minute into the weird atmospheric intro.
I like it because it does fit in with the album, with what he does at this point. Yes. And I like how they reworked it. You know, it's just like a completely different, you know, it's very like kind of like a grandiose, you know, kind of like the way the original was, but I love the way he does the verses. His singing is so good on this. Because, I mean, he sounds as good as he did on the original recording, but I love, like, the, you know, the kind of busy drumming in the background and...
It almost sounds like they just lifted the vocal track and pasted it onto this. So it's very faithful. The vocal track is very faithful.
Well, I mean, he's sang it so many times live that he's got it down, probably.
But at the same time, it's almost like they could have just written new words for this and it would have been a different song.
Yeah.
I can imagine that there's a lot of Deep Purple fans who have strong feelings about this version, with this being such a favorite of Deep Purple fans.
Well, I have strong feelings for it.
And I like that. It's like almost doubling the guitar, like doubling the vocals with like a synth or something in the background. It's hard to make out.
See, this is one of the songs that I love what the drums are doing in it. Like, for some reason, I really pay attention to what the drums are doing in this song.
And such a different feel with the guitar.
Yeah. I don't know. Just whatever he did with this version, they just did it so well. Like, it just had clicked.
It's really cool. I mean, I think it would have been super, I mean, some people might have been happier, but I think it would have been really disappointing if they tried to just do a faithful cover of the song.
Well, that's what I like about it, is like he put his own spin on his own song.
Yeah. They talk about how they ripped that whole dun, dun, dun thing off from another band. And in this case,
yeah, the drums.
Gone.
What he did with the cymbals.
Yep.
I love that.
Little snare roll. And Mark knows you can on top of it.
But yeah, Gillan basically like did like a new reimagining of his own song.
Yep.
And I love how raw he sounds here on his vocal. Like, you could tell he backed away from the microphone. He was just singing live. Like, he was just wailing it out. Here we go. Oh, so clean.
Mark knows he has a lot of roto pound. It's just such a chill vibe to this whole song. Doesn't have that build that the original one has, where it gets into this, whips itself up into this frenzy and then calms down again, and just the whole thing is just the same.
No, that's true. It definitely gives a whole new vibe to the song. It just kind of moves along at its own pace.
Production of the drums on the song is excellent. You get a really good sound feel for the room that it's in. But this is about 2.5 minutes shorter than the version on In Rock, I think. I'm doing my math correctly.
Yeah, because how long is the In Rock one?
I think it's close to 10 minutes.
Yeah, that makes sense.
It's like nine something?
Yeah, because the solo section is...
Yeah, it's a little over 10 minutes on In Raw.
Yeah, because they have like more build ups and they have more of a solo section, at least in the middle.
And honestly, we've talked about this in the earlier Deep Purple episodes too. Like, some of those songs are just a little too long. Like, what they were doing was impressive, but at a certain point you're like, wow, these songs are all 7-8 minutes long. And on this album, you're getting your average songs to be are around 3 minutes up until this point.
Yeah, so this one's like, you know, the seven minutes. So this is like definitely got to be the longest one. Well, right. This one does it for me. 5.
Whoa. All right.
I went from a 2.5 to a five. I love this. I love this version. Like, sometimes I'm torn between which version I like better.
Yeah, this is how you turned me on to this album, was just talking about this one version of the song. And I remember the first time I heard it, because it wasn't that long ago.
Yeah. And
I thought, wow, this is pretty incredible. So I'm still gonna go with a 4. I really dig it. I love the vibe of the song. I really like what they did with it. I think they took a huge chance on doing it at all, and even a bigger chance on doing it live and having their Deep Purple fans who came to see Ian Gillan say, "What the hell was that? It wasn't Child in Time." But that's what I love about Ian Gillan Band, is the chances that they took. And I read, and I wish I could remember where I read it, but I read somewhere, and I think it was a quote from one of them. It might have been Ray Fenwick or Johnny Gustafsson, saying something along the lines of that Ian Gillan pretty much just basically let them do whatever they want.
Mm-hmm.
Really gave them a lot of freedom to just do the instrumentation the way that they wanted to do it, and experiment and do new things. And that's what Ian Gillan wanted from this band, and that song proves that. Even though he's doing an old song excuse me, even though he's doing an old song, he's really putting a new spin on it, and it's and he's putting a new spin on his entire career. He's putting a new mm-hmm. spin on how he does everything here, and it shows. It's awesome.
Yeah, totally.
Okay, then that's it. I mean, the second side is short. It's only got 2 songs. They're the first side is filled with 2 minute and 45 second songs, or 3 minute songs, and the got 2 long ones for the end. And the second song on the second side of this album is called "Let It Slide."
Not to be confused with "Slide It In."
I knew you were gonna say that. And this is a very long song.
Oh, shoot.
So buckle up. We got an almost 12-minute song to close the album out.
Oh, boy. Here we go.
Yeah.
Forgot that we had one that this long on here.
Yeah, I knew it was long, but yeah, I didn't think about it as being that long.
See, it's like just so many extremes on this album. You have, like like you said, a ton of short songs, and then side two is like 2 long songs. It's like the Iron Butterfly album.
Yeah, right.
And you know, where like side one is like some songs, and then side two is like Inagata De Vita for 20 minutes or whatever. Yeah.
But you've got, again, another like really atmospheric beginning. We're almost a minute into it, and it's just noise. I mean, not to sound derogatory, but just noise and sounds and sound of wind and some banging drums.
I definitely think that, like, you know, these guys were really into the percussion aspect of things, just by how much, not only the list of percussion instruments that you read off, but I mean, you could just tell by the album, like the production of the drums is just like way up front, and they're just doing a lot of crazy stuff with the drums and percussion.
I think the percussion sets the tone for the whole album, and the same thing with the next album. It's the percussion makes it. It gives it that whole, the whole Ian Gillan Band sound.
Well, I mean, you know, you got to hand it to him. He didn't pick a bunch of slouches for his backing band.
No, and why would you if you're Ian Gillan?
Exactly.
So here we are, almost 2 minutes in. You get a drum beat starting. Some slide guitar. This song is written by all 5 of the principal members of the band: Gillan, Fenwick, Nozif, Gustafsson, and Morse. Verse sounds like, is it like Grand Funk or something? Is that a sound of?
What, this?
That verse, no, the verse part. It's reminding me of a song that I just can't put my finger on it.
Now we go back, I'll see if I can pick it out.
I'm gonna have to like text you at 2 in the morning.
Oh, I'm your captain.
Yes, thank you.
See, I told you I get it.
But does it
sound
a
little bit?
Is that Grand Funk?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, a little. It's got a little bit of the same like melody to it.
Yeah, the same kind of vibe.
But just like a hint, you know.
Almost into like a proggy sort of riff. I like stuff like this. Some people don't like.
It's like a Pink Floyd. I was gonna say a Pink Floyd, vibe to it.
It's like "Shine on You, Crazy Diamond." That was a little David Gilmour sort of. This whole thing, like the synth, what the synths are doing, and everything, very Pink Floyd. And I love Pink Floyd, so this definitely does it for me. But you get into that territory where is this a song or is this just kind of a mood? Even using a really Pink Floyd-y Rick Wright sort of patch there on the synth.
But at the same time, it's very Gillan. Like you detect a little bit of both if you're familiar with both bands.
But it's great. You've got this like weird like grand funkish sort of start to the song. This atmospheric start, then a grand funk little 2 or 3 minutes, and then you go into this almost Pink Floyd interlude sounding like it could be straight out of Wish You Were Here or Dark Side of the Moon. I wonder what happens if you sync this album up to The Wizard of Oz. Probably nothing.
Well, if you smoke enough pot, anything is possible. I think that when I was younger, I had tried that with some friends, or there were some friends that tried that, and I was like in the general vicinity of things. But
yep.
There was too much other shit going on for anybody to really pay attention, so I don't know that I really got anything out of it.
I've done it quite a few times, and I have like one that's already synced up to it, so you don't have to sync it yourself. It's fun if you're in.
Yeah.
If you want to give it a try. I really just keep expecting him just to be like, I'm young. And we got the motion. Just let it slide. Like, this song is for certain people. Like, I like having long, lengthy instrumental bits like that, where you can just kind of, like, zone out and check it out. Like, it would drive my wife insane.
Huh.
She would hate it.
I mean, for me, it really depends. Like, kind of like the long, epic, drawn-out ending of, like, Blind Men. That does it for me.
What's that?
Like, the long, epic, drawn-out, like, you know, ending to Blind Men.
Oh, Blind Men. Yes.
Blind Men. Or just, like, any of the, like, Deep Purple proper, like, you know, epically long jams that they have.
Yeah.
I think that things like this, while, like, they're interesting, they're technically good, you know, they probably, you know, really, they're really creative and stuff, it's got to hit, like, the individual in the right way for them to consider it, like, good.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like somebody else might be like, whoa, this is crazy awesome, I love it. Me, I'm just like, I'm just waiting until it's over at this point. It's not really, again, it's not really doing it for me.
Well, putting it on and having it on in the background while you're just kind of hanging out and having a good time is a lot different too than what we're doing right now, which is sitting and studying it. This kind of music doesn't lend itself super well to that. But I do like that. I like that little interlude. But you're at a certain time, you're like, is this... weird. It would be weird to have the filler track at the end of the album. Because like I said, it is a very short album.
Yeah, overall, right?
Yeah. Trying to look it up here. Runtime of the album is 36 minutes and 4 seconds.
Wow, that is very short.
Pretty short. It's like right on, it's on pace with like Who Do We Think We Are or some of the shorter albums like that. But here it is, there's almost 2 minutes left in the song and it feels like they're already fading it out. The genre that this is listed in Wikipedia is jazz fusion.
Yeah, I see that a lot of like Ian Gillan band albums are listed as that.
It has definitely a similar vibe to the song Five Moons from Clear Air Turbulence, but although I think that song kind of did it a little better. But yeah, that song, that album is straight up jazz fusion in some points.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a very mellow kind of stoner fade out on this song.
Gillan's stoner rock track.
Yeah, it's very very Pink Floyd-y. You were never huge into Pink Floyd, were you?
No, not at all. I mean, I've heard him enough on, you know, FM radio or whatever in the day to know what Pink Floyd should sound like. I mean, popular Pink Floyd.
Yeah, yeah. And Pink Floyd, again, is one of those bands that you got to be in the right mindset or the right mood to really appreciate. It's not for everybody. Yeah. I mean, it's enough for enough people. They've had a pretty successful...
yeah,
career,
but I mean, you know me, it's just like you know where I'm going with this. You know me, I'm like you know, yeah. most of that type of music, like I feel like when we, like in the maybe the late 90s or whatever, when like Pink Floyd and some of these bands were having what, their 25th or maybe 30th anniversary tours or whatever,
yeah,
so they were still like, you know, young-ish, I guess we could say around our age now. So they weren't like, they were classic rock, but they were like, you know, guys like in their 20s or whatever could see them. It's like bands like, you know, Pink Floyd and like the Rolling Stones and like even just any big like arena rock act, even like Bruce Springsteen, like just any big major arena draw like that. It was just like, I was never interested because it just seemed so like washed over and homogenized to me. You know, it's just like, you've heard it a million times. It's all over the radio. It's not really interesting. Like there's no, I don't know. You know what I mean? It's just like, I love a part of it to me is like the band's like backstory too.
Yeah.
Like Deep Purple's got like a great story. Kiss has a great story. Sabbath has a great story and history, you know, all the little bits and pieces and nooks and crannies and the stories that we all share. Like all the fans were like, ah, you know, that famous story about like, you know, when Ozzy got kicked out of the band and, you know, stuff like that. You know, it's like, I'm sure the other bands have it, but it's like, it's not as, I never latched onto it.
Yeah. So I mean, I was a pretty big Pink Floyd fan, but again, it's a different, it's a different feel than, than it's, I mean, it feels very similar to that. There's a lot of Pink Floyd in that last track, I think. But on the same token, you're sticking it on an album with like, the first side is almost all like quick little 3 minute songs. And then all of a sudden, boom, you've got these two really long songs at the end.
Yeah. That was pretty wild. It like, it was pretty obvious from everything from like the album art to like the like music contained on the album that like, Gillan didn't give a flying shit what anybody thought. He's like, I'm just going to do whatever I feel like doing. Just like now.
Yeah. I mean, it's just what he's always done. And it's great. Like that to me is like, even if some of these songs may not my favorite or whatever, I love what he was going with this album. And I love that this is what set up the next album, which I'm crazy about. Mm-hmm. And I think it was a great for him to try some new things. And in interviews, that's what he's kind of said about this band is it's like, hey, I tried some new stuff and some, it's not always, it doesn't always work out 100%.
Well, I'll give it an A for effort, but three for a rating.
I give it a 3.5.
Like I can definitely like, respect and appreciate it for sure. Yep. But
all right. So where does this, like, you know, where does this album stack up in the ratings?
Well, let me see, since I'm the official ratings looker upper. So let's see. So Child in Time gets a combined 7.0 rating. So our variance is very, very close. So I think we came in about the same. It's pretty average. Got a similar score to like Malice in Wonderland, Teaser, Play Me Out.
It's got even the same score as Deep Purple.
I'm sorry. I was looking at I was looking at just my ratings.
Oh. Well, it's got the same exact score as the Deep Purple album.
That makes sense.
Combined.
I think that makes some sense. So yeah, I think it got the same thing as like Cher Kazoo, Malice in Wonderland, scored a little lower than those, but everything else is like really higher. I think that I kind of brought the ratings down on this one because this album wasn't really my whole cup of tea. I loved the version of Child in Time on it, but not much more.
Yeah, and that was kind of my impression when I first heard this album. Is like that was kind of the standout, and the opening track I really liked. The rest of it was, you know, it's a first album with these guys getting together, and it's an amazing band on paper, but I think they were just trying to work things out and figure out their steps. And I think they took this, they went on tour with it and came back to the studio to do Clearer Turbulence, which again, I cannot say enough good things about. And it's a similar album in that it's got, I mean, there's a lot of long songs on it and long instrumentals. And I mean, God, Ray Fenwick's guitar solo in Clearer Turbulence has got to be like two minutes long, 2.5 minutes long.
Yeah.
But it's great. It's just such, there's such a feeling that that album evokes, at least with me. I think that album, they really hit the jackpot with that album. And, you know, I don't, I'm definitely not in the majority. The Ian Gillan Band was definitely not popular. Gillan was much, got a lot more, more with the fans, and
because it was more that, hard, but it was more hard rock,
right? And I think they had figured that out by the time they did Scarabus. They were trying to kind of like, okay, let's get a little bit more back to rock basics, even with Scarabus before they went into Gillan. And I think the thing I like the most about Clearer Turbulence is it's probably the most out there as far as Gillan's solo work, and it's musically one of the more interesting, in my opinion. And when he got back to the hard rock stuff, I was like, yeah, I mean, I like it. It's Gillan, and I'm going to like anything Gillan does. But it didn't stand out to me the same way that Clearer Turbulence did. But we're not talking about that yet.
No. So I would say, yeah, someday we will.
Someday. I can't wait.
But yeah, I think when you were saying like there was a group of musicians that got together and they really weren't like, you know, all meshed together yet or whatever, it makes me think of like Blackmore's Rainbow first album.
Exactly.
The way that we reviewed that, you know.
We've seen it before. They great group of musicians got together, did some really cool stuff, but it didn't quite click yet. And how could it? And these guys were together. So this came out in 76, and you know, he performed the Butterfly Ball late 75, October. And then by January, they're together with this band and recording this album, which comes out later that, you know, I don't know the exact date of the, what is the Ian Gillan? I should just leave this page open. I feel like I've opened the wiki for Ian Gillan Band. Child in Time, like seven times during this episode here. Yeah, it came out in July of 76. So they're in the studio just a few months after kind of hooking up at Butterfly Ball. And, you know, they wrote these songs, they record these songs, then they get back out there on the road a little bit and then come back to the studio again with a little bit more to go on. And it shows. So.
Yeah. But, I mean, you know, I feel like it just, like, every time I'm like, don't give an album or a band, like, a great rating, I just have to clarify that I do respect what the band has done. Like, I mean, I think they're great musicians and there's like a lot on there that I like. Like, I think, like you said, the percussion is really what drives the album. Like, it's what really makes the Ian Gillan Band albums like kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. But as a collection of songs, like the only thing I ever listened to off this album is I skip right to Child in Time. I mean, it may as well have just been released as a single, you know, as far as I'm concerned, because I never listen to any of the other songs on this album. And, you know, you can probably see why. It's like, I usually like stuff that I can like, you know, bop my head along to or just get into. And it doesn't really connect with me. So.
Yep. Fair enough. So when this album came out, it was reviewed by the Deep Purple Appreciation Society. They would launch the magazine Darker Than Blue. Back in the 70s, it was called Stargazer. And in their issue number 7 in June or July of 1976, they reviewed this album. And am I reading the right one here? Oh, yes. Yeah, the production has left the potential of the band completely hidden. It's overproduced to a point where the group's natural energy sounds contrived. It's usually the drive and freshness of a new band which attracts attention. Gillan sings on typical rock themes, i.e. bed, but the backing is incongruous. Everything has a soft Americanized touch and is altogether too rich. It will appeal more to the 25 to 35 age group. It sounds old. And then they had a little report that says Ian Gillan's personnel is changing faster than Blackmore's. Keyboard player Mike Moran was replaced for the French tour by Mickey Lee Soul, who was in turn replaced by Colin Townes after the tour before they left for America. And then in Dave Thompson's book, Smoke on the Water, Gillan says about their first show, the audience went berserk as soon as we walked out on stage. They were hyped up, ready to headbang and everything else. And our opening number went, dink dink a dink 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 a dink. It was a jazzy funky thing, and the crowd didn't know what was happening. They were going, "Hey, what the hell's that?" But we stuck with it. You've got to do what you believe in. You've got to take risks. Fenwick says a lot of the Deep Purple fans were getting a little unhappy. Hey, Ian's getting funky, and of course, by the time the second album, Clear Air Turbulence, that terrible word jazz was coming in. But the worst thing we could have done was be another Deep Purple. We started to really experience, and by the time we got to the third album, Scarabus, although we started doing shorter songs because we were thinking about radio play, we were also getting into some really strange stuff. And we got this little review here titled Gillan, Not Deep Enough.
Gillan, disappointing.
Yeah. There's a picture of Gillan, and that's a picture of him from, I think, from the Butterfly Ball singing. Yeah. And it says Gillan, colon, disappointing.
That's an awful caption. That's not a great picture of him either. He looks like he's like all chubby and.
Yeah, it's not a great. Not a great picture, not a great review. It says, maybe the storming excellence of one-time Purple stablemate Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow second album has prejudiced by ability to enjoy this. Ian Gillan's debut solo LP, I don't know, but after listening to Child in Time a few times, the word that springs to mind most readily is disappointing. He goes into the history of how he left the band. We all know this. He said, that said, there's plenty to be satisfied by the long, frustrated Purple fan, especially the opening track, Lay Me Down, which is in the fine Fireball and Strange Kind of Woman tradition. But generally, the songs have little shape or definite form and fade unceremoniously when they end. The final result, I think, is rather akin to Bad Company, good enough, but failing to approach the heights of Free's musical ability and originality. With the Gillan band, you'll probably spin this album, think, okay, and then drive straight for your copy of In Rock to see how it used to be done.
Mm.
Jeff Barton.
I actually think that he was kind of like on the money with that, because didn't I say that a lot of the songs kind of sounded like they didn't really go anywhere?
Yeah, yeah. And so, we've seen that before. We saw that a little bit with Play Me Out. And some... Yeah, I think... Looking at these critically, I've definitely has opened my eyes to seeing things a little bit more like they're not going anywhere. There's one final review here. This is from the Winnipeg Free Press. This one's a little harder to read. It says, following several years of musical inactivity, longtime Deep Purple lead singer Ian Gillan has returned to action as the leader of his own five-piece band. It talks about, again, some of the history. Most of Side of One is devoted strongly to strong rhythmic rockers like You Make Me Feel So Good and Lay Down. Although much of the material lacks the relentless drive and intensity of his former group's best work, Gillan and crew reveal considerable promise on the bulk of the songs. The second side contains just two selections. It opens with a slowed-down reworking of Child in Time, a song which originally appeared on Deep Purple's In Rock. Gillan doesn't match his incredible performance on the original, although the new version does have its merits. A moodily atmospheric 11-minute track entitled Let It Slide gives keyboard player Mike Moran ample opportunity to display his talents. It ends by saying, Gillan has assembled an exceptionally talented musical aggregation, which also includes sometimes Roxy Music bassist John Gustafson, former Spencer Davis Group guitarist Ray Fenwick, and percussive expert Mark Nosseeff. Former Deep Purple bass guitarist Roger Glover, who split from the group in the same time as Gillan, turns in another top-notch production job. I'm already looking forward to the group's second album, which could really be a knockout. For the nonce, Child in Time serves as a more than satisfactory reintroduction to a tremendously talented performer who has been out of the spotlight for far too long. Far too long. It had been like 3 years at that point. Now, Guns N' Roses in the album for like 15 years working on an album. They're like, Gillan's been gone for far too long. It's amazing how much faster things moved back then.
A whole 3 years.
How long has it been since, between Deep Purple albums? So that's kind of reviews of Child in Time.
Yeah.
Don't have any news to go over this week, but we do have of course, some history. And what happened on this is for the week of January 13th through the 19th. And on the 19th, what happened in 1947? Well, if you don't know, I'll tell you. Rod Evans was born.
Rod.
That's look my at favorite, him. My favorite picture of Rod.
Look at him, that handsome devil.
Handsome little Elvis guy. Love Rod Evans. On January 13th, 1973, Deep Purple releases John's favorite Deep Purple album, Who Do We Think We Are? Featuring his favorite Deep Purple song. Place in the line.
Oh, the worst Bob Dylan song that Bob Dylan never wrote.
Bob Dylan. Did you say that on the episode? That was a Bob Dylan-ish.
I feel like that's what his vocal performance was like. I might have said it.
In the lane. I could hear it now.
They should have just given the song to Dylan. He probably was like, "No thanks.
Well, you think you're gonna make it?" I could see him do it. That'd be great.
What if he was
gonna take it now?
What if he was on Play Me Out?
It's a piece.
I think that should be a thing. Every episode we should do one vocalist that's not Glenn Hughes doing that line.
Doing space.
So far Rod Evans was the funniest. See, even thinking about it now is making me laugh again. Space. What made it funny was I wasn't expecting it. So,
yeah, exactly. Now it's going to be expected. Any new vocalist we mention. And then on January 15th, 2006, Dream Theater gets together in Osaka and forms the entirety of Made in Japan.
Wow, that's a pretty faithful reproduction of the album cover.
Yeah, it's got that. Like kind it of, fooled I, me. I don't. For a second. They were in Osaka. I can only assume they're in the same venue, unless it was a different venue in Osaka. But that's definitely on my short list of things I'd like to cover one day. Is the Dream Theater doing Made in Japan? That'd be really exciting to check out. Dream Theater.
That sounds cool.
Incredible, incredible, talented band. Too talented almost. But yeah, that should be fun. And interesting thing about this version is Roger Glover mixed it.
Interesting.
He knows a thing or two about Made in Japan. So that's it. That's it for Child in Time. That's it for our history. And until next week, we're going to cover another incredible album, which I've already forgotten what it is. Oh, now I remembered. But we won't tell you. You'll have to wait till next week.
You can see my impression of it if you've got video.
Yeah, well, you can't because I'm talking, so you won't see it.
All right. Damn it.
You'll have to talk and do it.
Here, this one right here. Who can guess this?
All right, if you can't wait till next week, you can check us out at the end of this episode on YouTube, and you'll get a clue. So, All right. Well, speaking of that, until next week, I'll talk to you later.
Peace out.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple Podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also give us a rating on iTunes to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.